morning.
Good morning.
Amen. Amen. Today is actually the feast of St. Alexander. I know we have some Alexanders in our congregation this morning. Today we have happy name for today. Welcome to our visitors. If you are new to our parish, we warmly welcome you. If you are staying in Tampa and like to join our parish, please follow the light connection cards and the pews in front of you and give today's readers who are your one of four who are in their choir and Skip Hinton, who is in the back, and our ambassador Pablo Aviles, who is right over there, and they will get you connected with our community. We have a very active community this morning before liturgy. We had to start very early. I had two 40-day blessings of babies, which is awesome. That's good. Second time that's happened in the last 3 weeks, we've had two of them before liturgy starts. And after church, we are having an altar meeting, so I'm asking all the boys to serve the altar together with at least one of their parents. If you will please stay for a meeting as soon as I get out of here, I'm going to get my vestments off. We'll start right away. We have 43 altar boys signed up to serve this year, which is awesome. And tonight at 5 o'clock, we're going to kick off our Goya for the year. We'll have our Goya kick off at 5 o'clock. Again, all our Goyans are invited. One parent each way can come. We'll have a parents meeting also kind of go over things for the year with the parents. A couple other announcements. The father of George Norlis, and how many of you know George, but him and his wife Cheryl are usually sitting about halfway back this side of the night of the day. They're usually here before liturgy. They're very wonderful, pious, and quiet people. George's father passed away this week. They just brought him down to New York, so none of you would know him. George and Cheryl. Josiah is going to be this afternoon at 4 o'clock at Plow Prairie down the street. The funeral will be tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock here at St. John's. Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock, we'll have divine liturgy for the beginning of the ecclesiastical year. Our church year actually starts on September the 1st, and the church custom is for that day to be commemorated with divine liturgy. It's also proclaimed by our patriarch as the day of the environment. We come and we pray about our creation, about the earth, about all the people and things on it. So that will be Tuesday at 10 o'clock. And finally, last Sunday, I gave a sermon about our dome that has plaster falling off of it. We didn't clean it up this morning because it was actually way more than there was last week, and I was kind of embarrassed to have a church like that. So thank you to Charlie for cleaning it up this morning. But we were able to raise $3,000 last week just off of that sermon. More information coming. We'll probably need about $100,000. Fix the ductwork and ultimately the dome. Again, it's our church, it's our home, and it's our responsibility. And again, more to come on that. Whatever you feel inclined to do, however, it's much appreciated. The messenger should be to you very shortly. We got our once in church, so hopefully the next day or so they should be in your homes. But I'm quoting a book that, in my article, and I've talked to some of you about this book as well, it's not about me. It's a very short book with large print, people like David don't like reading. I don't read very many books in the year, it's just not one of my gifts. But when I read something and really and make it through it, then it must be a good book. It holds my attention, it's very hard to read. And I want to read you one page of this book, it's not about me, because it has to do with the gospel reading this morning, about being tenants. You're acquainted with house sitters. You possibly use one. Not wanting to leave your house vacant, you ask someone to stay in your home until you return. Let me describe the two of your nightmares. The house sitter redecorates your house. White paint is changed to pink, Berber carpet to shag carpet, an abstract plastic chair sits in the place of your cozy love seat. His justification? The house didn't express me accurately. I need a house that communicated who I am. Your response? It's not yours. My residence does not exist to reflect you. I ask you to take care of the house, not take over the house. Would you want a sitter like this? You might choose to over nightmare number two. She didn't redecorate, she neglected. Never washed a dish, made a bed, or took out the trash. My time here was temporary. I hear you wouldn't mind, she explains. Of course you'd mind. Does she know what this abode cost you? Both house sitters made the same mistake. They acted as if the dwelling was theirs. So this morning, in the Gospel of Matthew, we read a parable of the Lord. The kingdom of heaven will be like this. There was a householder who planted a vineyard, put a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, put a tower over it, and he lent it out to tenants. People that he expected to tend the vineyard. And when he came back, he expected to receive something on his investment. Now these were tenants. They were not slaves. He didn't make them be in the vineyard. They voluntarily signed up to be tenants in the vineyard. And so the master then went away and left the tenants to do the work of the vineyard. And when the season of the harvest came, the master of the vineyard sent servants to see what the tenants had done with the vineyard he entrusted them. And when the tenants saw the servants coming, they took one and they beat one, and they killed another, and they stoned another. Now the master of the vineyard didn't say, "Let me send an army of soldiers and eradicate those people." He said, "Let me give them another chance. I will send more servants." And the tenants saw the more servants coming, and they said, "Let's do the same to them." So they treated them shamefully and destroyed them. Then the master of the vineyard said, "Again, I'm not going to destroy those people. I will give them another chance. I won't even send them servants. I will send them my very own son." And the tenants, they had no respect for the man's servants, so they had no respect for his son. In fact, they said, "Now this is an opportunity. Let's kill the son, and then we can have the vineyard for ourselves as an inheritance." Now, the meaning of this parable, the Lord is addressing this parable to his chosen people, people of Israel, who are treating the Lord shamefully, and they're not listening to his words. And he's foretelling of his passion. We read this gospel actually during Holy Week. And the servants who came to the vineyard first, these were the prophets. The master of the vineyard obviously is the Lord. And the tenants of the vineyard are the children of Israel, who were disobedient and disrespectful. And the Lord said, "I will send prophets to try and correct them of their wayward ways." And the people of Israel didn't listen to the prophets. So the Lord said, "I'm going to send more prophets." And they didn't listen to them either. In fact, they killed many of them and treated them wrongfully. So finally the Lord said, "I will send my own son, and perhaps then they will get it." But the people of Israel, they said, "Ah, this is the son. Let's kill him." And so they killed the son of God. Now, the lesson of the parable, what do you think the owner of the vineyard is going to do when he comes to deal with tenants? And of course, people said, he will put those people to a miserable death, let out the vineyard to other tenants, and will give them the fruits of their seasons. And Jesus said to them, "Have you never read the scriptures? The very stone the builders rejected has become the head of the corner. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes." And if you read on one other verse, which I wish was included today, but I'll share it with you. Jesus said, "Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation producing the fruits of it." The kingdom of God will be taken away from the chosen people and given to other people that will respect what is the intent. Years ago on Palm Sunday night, when I gave this sermon about this topic, I brought some blocks and built something. And I forgot to bring my blocks this morning, so you just have to imagine. I took some children's blocks and started building something with it, but I left one of the blocks at the bottom askew. And as I was building on top of that, you could obviously see that the foundation was not solid. And to keep building on this, ultimately it fell down, because the foundation wasn't set the right way. And that's the same with, I'm not an engineer, but I'm imagining that's the same with any building. If the foundation isn't solid, you can build all you want, and eventually your building is going to come tumbling down. Or you can take the building down brick by brick, redo the foundation, and then build something again on a strong foundation, and then it has lasting value. Of course, you tell that to a child who's building something incorrectly, and they see how far they've gotten, and you say, you know, son, take that down. You can't build the thing you want in its totality. Now we have to take a detour and take some time and take apart what you did and redo it so we can do it the right way. The foundation is very important for what you're building on. And I know that many of us turn the news on and we watch the news, and day after day, we're hearing stories of terrible things. A woman got up and was doing her job in a newscast, interviewing another lady, and the cameraman was shooting the whole thing on film, and some lunatic came and killed two of them and hurt the other one. And the other night, a police officer in Texas was just pumping gas. Someone came and killed him because he was wearing a uniform and he didn't like that. And every day we hear stories of people about which lives matter in this country. All lives matter. All the lives matter to God. We don't need hashtags saying certain lives matter. All the lives matter. But what is sad when our country is in the foundation of everything, instead of it being the Lord, which is how our nation was founded, one nation under God, the foundation has actually become anger. The peace of God eludes people that are full of anger. It's all about what I want. What I want. What fits me. And I don't care about you. That is what the foundation of our country is becoming. Now, our God is a God of peace. And where there is peace, there can't be this kind of anger. And our God is also a God of love. And love, by its definition, means to take something of me and to project it to you. I can't love myself. I can respect myself, I can have confidence in myself, but I can't take from me and give to me. That is self-serving. So if I take my time and I give it to you, or I take my money and I give it to you, or I take a talent and I give it to you, that is love. I can't take my money and then give it to myself. That is not love. I can't take my talent and give it to myself. That is not love. To love is to take something of you and to give it to someone else. And that might be, that thing might be what you think belongs to you, what you think is owed to you. Let's say that you're tired and you lay down this afternoon to take a nap. And your spouse says, you know, honey, all week I've been thinking that we need to repaint the guest room. And you say, no, I am tired. I am owed a nap. Love is when you say, I want to take the thing, even the thing I think should be mine, the 2 hours to take a nap, and I will give it to you out of love. I won't get up begrudging and say, oh, only because I'm married to you and I want dinner tonight. Or any other reason. Say, I will do that because I love you. I will take what, even what I think is mine, even the thing I think I'm entitled to, and I will give you that anyway, out of love. That's what love is. Love is not standing your ground and saying, no, 2 hours is mine. How dare you ask for it? Or so-and-so thing is mine. How dare you want it? That's not love. That's self-serving. And this is the foundation, unfortunately, that our country is being built on. It's all about what I want. And who cares about you? I have a right to this. That's not what love is. The only thing I have a right to is God's love. But if I set myself in a posture of gratitude, so that if my spouse says, paint the room, then the first thought is, thank you, God, that I have a spouse who's asking me. And thank you, God, that I have a room to paint. Then it sets me in the right way. The foundation of our life is supposed to be love, taking everything we have and being ready to offer to somebody else. Everything up to our own life. That's what God did for us. He didn't say, I'll give you the leftovers of my emotions. I'll give you what I don't need. He said, I'll give you everything, including my own life. And this is what love is. Greater love has no man than this. He laid down his life for his friends. This is the greatest love of all. And you look at what's going on in the news. I lost my job. I'm going to go kill somebody. I don't like cops. I'll go kill one of them. I don't like this. I'm going to go hurt somebody. I don't like you. I'm going to go shoot you. This is not what God intended. This is not what God intended at all. And the Lord delivers a warning in the gospel lesson. Do something with the thing I've lent you. I've lent you your home. I've lent you your life. I've lent you this country. I've lent you your talents. We're all tenants. I'm not an owner. Someone pointed out, I'm not a homeowner. It's in the government owns your house. You have to be taxed for you when you pay the mortgage off. And when you die, you don't own the house forever and ever. So I'm really a tenant. I'm a tenant of this church. I'm a tenant of this job. I'm a tenant of my family. And when it's all over, God expects something on his investment. And the Lord delivers a dire warning to his people. I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation producing the fruits of it. So, I don't know about our nation. This is a political thing at all. Leave our nation out of it. It's our own, it starts our own community, our own backyard, our own families. Take care of what God has given us and do it with love. Do it with love and compassion, taking off of me and giving to you. And how do we do that? The official meeting says that. Stand firm in faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. Even when you've had to do something unpleasant or say something unpleasant, there is a loving way to do it. You don't have to be angry about it. It's funny that we're going to listen ad nauseum to politics until the election, and then we'll start the whole cycle over again. And I was thinking about this today. The basis of every political campaign has nothing to do with service. It has to do with, I'm better than the other guy. I'm going to destroy the other guy, so he'll vote for me. Now, the real person who wants to serve says, I'm here to serve. And if you want me to serve, you want this one to serve, you want that one to serve, I'm here to serve in whatever way that service is needed. And even that would get wrong. If you're here to serve, it's not about you. It's about the other guy. If you're here to love, it's not about you. It's not about the other guy. And ultimately, it's not about me or you. It's all about him. It's him, you can